We cry. No? Why is it makruh? No, not makruh. The only things for the woman, makruh, you raise your voice in crying. But crying is not makruh. Actually, crying is a preferred. Because the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the hadith, he said, when you recite Quran and you recite something about hell and punishment, you cry. If you do not cry, imitate crying. Yeah. So crying in the salat, in the reciting Quran, is not makruh. It is actually preferred to. But so some women, they raise the voice when they cry. Ah, this is a makruh. So when you raise the voice with the crying. Okay, madam. So, our ulama, because there is many hadith, Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and Sahaba, they correct people when they pray. Example, one of these things, Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, one day he comes to the masjid and one of the people praying and he looking like that to the sky. And Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told him, so you are not allowed to look to the sky when you pray. You are not allowed. And in other hadith, so Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and Sahaba, many of them, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Umar ibn Khattab, so in different Sahaba, they come to the masjid, they saw people doing like that, praying like that. And what they do, they raise their head. Mean looking here is not allowed. Looking to the ground under us, not allowed. So that's why, what the ulama said, we are not allowed to look up, we are not allowed to look down. So what we have to look in that this direction. So I mean our head here and our eyes that direction. So this is the direction we have to look. You got the idea? Sorry? Ah. Yeah, that's why this is the idea. Because if you look down like that, it is prohibited. Because we have hadith prevent you from doing that. So that where to look? Up, not allowed. So that's why our ulama, so this is the direction. So that's why there is no specific point you can point, I have to look there. So you have this distance, okay? You have this distance, you look there. So this is how you look. You got it? So you are not allowed to look like that because it is prohibited. You are not allowed to look like that because it is prohibited. So this is the destination you have to look to. So your head should be straight because Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam prohibit us from like that. So our head should be straight. So when our head is straight, so the eyes should be in that direction. So this is the distance, so we say you have to look to. So that's why there is no specific point, but we have this destination. To combine all the hadith together. Yes. Yeah, Jumhur said in the masjid only. Only Ahnaf said allowed in the house for the woman if you already allocate place in your house for prayer. But majority of the ulama say only in the masjid. So, because there is another hadith, they said when you make khalwa, so that's why I said why the woman complain? Allah give them everything in an easy way. And they complain. Just imagine, brothers and sisters, they still complain. Allah told me if you want to get this reward, you have to go to the masjid and tell the women you can get it to pray in the house. And they complain. You got the same reward in your house. I have to get it in the masjid. Many hadith or many of Rasul talking about if the woman making khalwa with Allah in her house. is not a tikaf khalwa. I mean, you find a place in your house and you sit, you make tasbih. And that hadith says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you something you cannot imagine. Means Allah already replaced the i'tikaf in the masjid to you with something else. You just sit in your house alone, lock your door, make khalwa with Allah for 2 or 3 hours. You are getting ajr maybe better than my i'tikaf in the masjid. The hadith, I cannot mention the statement exactly, that, but the meaning is the خلوة المرأة مع ربها في بيتها تعدل كذا. I mean, when the woman stay in the home, allocate time only for her God, she did not talk with anyone, she did not do any job, she just خلوة for Allah, do tasbih, ذكر, all these things. So Allah will give her something, cannot imagine.
Unfortunately, the
Muslim
style is, for example, the last 10 days of Ramadan.
Hmm.
People will go to the
masjid. Yeah, because this is what.
They will do
itikaf. This is Azwaj al-Rasul, the wife of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They do itikaf in the masjid. Why? Because the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam always last 10 days he stays in the masjid. After Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam died, his wife, because they love him, they start imitating him. So the last 10 days they go to the masjid. Azwaj Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So after that, what they said, since Ummahatul Mu'mineen, they go to the masjid last 10 days, we go like that. But this is not the sunnah of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You got it? This is the sunnah of Azwaj Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Because when Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam passed away, because they love him, so every Ramadan they do the same with him, like him. So this is the idea. But it is not sunnah from Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, did not say that to the women you go and do i'tikaf in the masjid. So I mentioned that Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, did I pray? He said, no, stay in your home and your ajr is better. So this is the idea. I forgot. Inshallah today. I'll come. This is the problem of we are affected from waste. Anything for man should be exactly the same for women. Allah give you something else which is equal to us. Why you want to be like us? You got the idea, madam? Because we are affected with the West. Anything for man should be exactly the same for women. In Islam, we don't have that. That's one, we don't have it. In Islam, no. This is for man, and this is something else for woman. It is L, but equal to this one in ajr. So you look as a woman, what Allah gives to you to get your ajr, and you will go to the Jannah. That's it. Which is, I guarantee you, is an easy way. Allah, what give to you is easier than what they give to us. And the same ajr. So, is there, women, they talk about jihad. Why? Because, you know, jihad is the highest ajr in Islam. You cannot get ajr higher than jihad. So women start thinking, okay, man got jihad. Which is the highest ajr. I mean, definitely there is no ajr higher than jihad. After La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, this is the highest in Islam. After it, immediately jihad. Because the Rasulullah said, Zarwatu salam al-Islam. This is the top of everything in Islam. So women start thinking, okay, man got jihad. We don't have something equal. So they went to Rasulullah, they asked. And what did Rasulullah? He said, your work, the effort that you give in your house is equal to jihad. Can you believe that? Yes? We go and fight and die, and they stay home, they go sell ajr. And they complain. So that's why, you know, some women, I want to, why you want to go out? Go take care of your family, you will go to the highest level of Jannah. This is what Allah promised you. Your job, take care of your family, you will go to the highest level of Jannah. No, I want to be like man. Okay. You want to get tired in the dunya and in the akhirah you got nothing. No comment, right?
What was it? There was two women doing the battle, went to the wall with the
capital. Because, you know, sometimes, because for example, for cooking, because they need food, right? Who cook for them? Nursing, for example. Okay? Because all men busy, because in that time, you know, the number of the Muslim is, the man is very limited. So they all of them busy, because you know, for example, I give you the battle of Al-Yarmouk between Muslim and Roman. The number of the Muslim army, 12,000. The number of the enemy, 240,000. Now, no man can be allocated to any other job, because it is, they are only 12. They have to fight 240. So that's why all men should be involved in the war. Then who will do the other job? So that's why they took the women with them to do these jobs, because men cannot do it. So this is the idea of why they take the women with them to the war. Now today, no, we want to fight like a man. Train us to. Why you want to do that? You have a job. Okay, we go to inshallah to hadith. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Number 59. An Abi Huraira radiallahu anhu qal, asfalu salati ala al-munafiqin salatu al-isha'i wa salatu al-fajri. Walau ya'lamuna ma fihima la'atawhuma walau habwa. ولقد هممت أن آمر بالصلاة فتقام ثم آمر رجلا فيصلي بالناس ثم أنطلق معي برجال معهم حزم من حطب إلى قوم لا يشهدون الصلاة فأحرق عليهم بيوتهم بالنار. The meaning of the hadith, الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم said, the heaviest صلاة to perform for منافقين العشاء and الفجر. Mean for munafiqeen, not for the believer, good believer, for munafiqeen, the heaviest salat is Isha and Fajr in the masjid, to perform that in the masjid. So that's why, even today, see who pray Isha and Fajr in the masjid. Those who did not go, then you suspect they are munafiq. Because this is what Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said. Taqila, taqila mean heavy to perform. Okay? And Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, I have intention inside me, that when the salat come, I order a person to be imam, leading people in the salat, and I will take a man to me, I will go to those men in their house who did not pray in the masjid with us, I burn their house. So Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam here want to insist that praying for man in the masjid is very important. To the way that Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, he said, I would like if those who did not pray in the masjid, I burn their house. So how much important for man to pray in the masjid? So this is very important. And that hadith, actually there is many things in we can understand. The importance of Salatul Jama'ah for the man. And also punishment for those who did not pray Jama'ah. So the imam have a right to punish, I mean Amir al-Mu'mineen, so have a right to punish those people who did not pray in the Masjid Jama'ah. And this is what happened now in Saudi Arabia, for example. During the Salat, all shops should close. So if any shop open, they will summon him. So during the Salat, no one allowed to open any shop, any restaurant, all closed. Because the prayer time, you have to go to the Masjid and pray there. So this is what the authority giving to the Amir al-Mu'minin or to the Imam. He can punish people who did not pray in the Masjid.
So is it in every part of Saudi or in
yes. Everywhere. All Saudi Arabia. And they have a group, they call the Hayat al-Amr bil-Ma'ruf wa-Nahy al-Munkar. So there is a group, there is a government group, a government organization, like for example, they say what's called JAE, something like that. So that group, their job only to observe people during the prayer. They did not pray with the people Jama'ah. During the prayer, they have their car and they moving in the road. Anyone open the shop, they go immediately and summon. So those people pray after. Like UIA, Islamic University, still we have a class during the Salat.
so we shouldn't.
Yeah, shouldn't, because it's salah time. Should be break. At least give half an hour. There is no class in this half an hour. People to pray. We don't have it. Especially Asr. That last time I have 2 days, 4 to 6. 2 days, 4 to 6. But by law, we are not allowed to do that, right? By the rule of regulation, we are not allowed to do that, right? Yeah. So, but sometimes students maybe have something else, or they have program, or another class, or replacement class. Sometimes they have replacement class. Yeah.
Oh, night class, sir. Night class.
Yeah.
About night class.
Yeah, that's why we should avoid the salah time. We have a lot of program during the salah. Yeah, a lot of programs during the summer.
So awareness is not
there. I like USIM. USIM, they have very, very good system. Their system, 8 to 5. There is no class after 5. There is no program after 5. At all. During the weekend, there is no program, there is no class, nothing in USIM. Yeah. They said this is fair for everyone. We are a government university. We are using government time, which is 8 to 5. So if you have a program, make it 8 to 5. So you want to make your own program? Go and do it, but don't tell the university to attend or to sponsor. If you want the university to sponsor or to attend, it should be 8 to 5. It's very good. This is a system. UIA, we don't have system. So sometimes they call us to come on Sunday, on Saturday, right? It is not fair for us. I have family, this is UIA, this is contract, you have to follow the rule of regulation. Which is not fair, not just for us, right? So even sometimes it's a student activity. Sunday and Saturday, we have to attend. Because I'm course coordinator, so when any time society have program, I have to attend. And all these programs, Sunday and Saturday. Yeah, sometimes at night. Why I should come at night? At night is not the university time, it's my time, right?
How did the USIM students do conduct talks? How did they conduct?
During the 8 to 5. After 5, the university will not force any lecturer to attend. If the students want to do activity, they still can do activity, but you cannot ask a lecturer to come. If you want, go individually ask them, but you cannot send official letter to tell the staff to come after 5. This is the idea. So if the students want, for example, you to attend, they have to ask you personally, but they cannot send official letter. But they are very tough, 8 to 5. Even the main gate, you cannot go out unless you. And you listen, I go to visit my friend, we want to go to take lunch outside. When he want to go out, he have to, the security did not allow him to go. He have to use punch out, and then when he come back, punch in again. Very tough for that, very tough. Okay, hadith number 60. An Abdullah bin Umar radiyallahu anhuma an Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qala idha sta'zanat ahadukum imra'atuhu ila al-masjid fala yamna'ha. Qala faqala Bilal bin Abdullah wallahi lam na'ahunna. Qala fa aqbala alayhi Abdullah fasabbahu sabban sayyan. Ma sami'tuhu sabbahu mithlahu qat. فقال أخبرك عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وتقول والله لم نعنا. The hadith is Abdullah bin Umar. He was telling people around him. One of them, his name is Bilal bin Abdullah. Not Bilal, another one. His name Bilal bin Abdullah. And then Abdullah bin Umar was telling them that the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, if your wife or the woman under your wilaya come to you and ask you to go to the masjid, don't prevent them. So this is what the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said. And the Bilal said, no, I will prevent them. So Bilal, he said, I will prevent them. So Abdullah ibn Umar was very angry, and he started saying very bad words to Bilal. And the one who listened, he said, I never heard Abdullah ibn Umar saying these bad words before. And Abdullah ibn Umar was very angry. He said, I told you, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and you say no? That's why he's angry in a way, become like crazy. Why? Because he said, you know, when you say Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, everyone have to accept, right? And this person said, no, I will not accept that. Then he rejected Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's statement. So that's why Abdullah ibn Umar was very angry. And we explained that yesterday. We said, in some cases, Islam allowed us to go angry to that level. In some cases, but this is not always. This is only exceptional cases. Exceptional cases. So from that hadith, what we understand, that women allowed to go to the masjid, and men have no right to prevent her from going to masjid if she want to go. Any? No. عن عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنهما قال صليت مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ركعتين قبل الظهر وركعتين بعدها وركعتين بعد الجمعة وركعتين بعد المغرب وركعتين بعد العشاء وفي لفظ فأما المغرب والعشاء والجمعة ففي بيته وفي لفظ أن ابن عمر قال حدثتني حفصة أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يصلي سجدتين خفيفتين بعدما يطلع الفجر وكان الساعة لا أدخل على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فيها. So the meaning of the hadith, Abdullah ibn Umar said, now he did not talk about the fard, because we have fard, right? This one about nafila, sunnah. Abdullah ibn Umar, he said, I pray with the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam two rak'at before dhuhr, two rak'at after dhuhr, two rak'at after jum'ah prayer, two rak'at after maghrib, and two rak'at after isha. So this is Wallah Abdul Rahman. This is what Abdullah ibn Umar prayed. Because as we say, later inshallah we will go, there's one session for that. Later inshallah. Not now. Yeah. Two rak'at before dhuhr. Two rak'at after dhuhr. Two rak'at after jum'ah prayer. Two rak'at after maghrib. Two rak'at after isha. Actually, there is one session later, inshallah, one chapter only for this tawafil. That's why the details, inshallah, we'll leave it there. Because there is many different hadith about how many Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam pray before and after. And then the ulama divided. I will just give you the division. Later, inshallah, we'll go to details. The ulama divided to sunnah mu'akkada wa sunnah ghair mu'akkada. Sunnah mu'akkada, that the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam never left. Always pray. Mean Rasulullah sallam always pray it. That's why they call it sunnah muakkada. Like this two rak'at before dhuhr, two rak'at before after dhuhr. Rasulullah sallam never miss, never in all life. But there is another hadith. Rasulullah sallam sometimes pray four after dhuhr, four before dhuhr, four after dhuhr. So now when we say four after before dhuhr, mean two of them is sunnah mu'akkada, two of them sunnah ghair mu'akkada. Mu'akkada mean always. When we say mu'akkada mean always pray. Sunnah ghair mu'akkada mean sometimes do, sometimes don't do. So that's why our ulama say for this hadith, what Abdullah ibn Umar mentioned is the sunnah mu'akkada only. What Abdullah ibn Umar mentioned this hadith, what is the sunnah? Mu'akkada only. Later, inshallah, we have one chapter only to discuss the details of this one. But there is another thing in this hadith. Abdullah ibn Umar said, the two rak'at of Maghrib and Isha and Jum'ah, he pray in the masjid. In his house. He pray in his house. And actually, this is most of the time, Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam prays the sunnah in the house, not in the masjid. He prays the masjid only the rukun. But this sunnah before, after, most of the time, not all the time, most of the time, Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam pray in the house. Why? To make your house also have a part of the ibadah, not only the masjid. So you have some of the ibadah in your house, some of the ibadah in the masjid. And there is Hafsa, in the same hadith, Abdullah ibn Umar said Hafsa because Hafsa his sister. Hafsa his sister is the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is the sister of Abdullah ibn Umar. And Abdullah ibn Umar said, my sister Hafsa told me that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he prayed two rak'at before Fajr. And later inshallah we will see another hadith for Aisha. These two rak'at after Fajr is the most, before Fajr, is the most sunnah mu'akkada. There is no prayer, not compulsory. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did like these two rak'at before Fajr. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam really never missed. And not only that, there's many hadith Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he talk about the importance of these two rak'at. The importance of these two rak'at before Fajr. But we have to observe, these two rak'at before Fajr should be very light. Because I see some people in the masjid, when they pray it, they make it long. Why is this again is the sunnah? Because the sunnah of this two rak'at should be very light. Even there is one hadith, one of the sahaba said, I thought Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam read nothing in it. It seemed like he read nothing. Means it fast in a way that it seemed Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam read nothing, only Fatiha maybe. So this two rak'at should be light. Some people pray this two rak'at, they make it long. So no, this two rak'at before Fajr should be light. The other, yes, can be long. The other can be long. But this two rak'at, the sunnah should be very light. Very light. And also there is another thing in the hadith. Yes.
Sorry, the one is in the house or in the mosque?
In the house.
The Fajr,
yes.
Fajr.
Yeah. Because you know this is nawafil, all the nawafil, we call it nawafil. All the nawafil, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed mostly in the house, but sometimes he prayed in the masjid. No, not all the time in the masjid, not all the time in the house. Sometimes in the masjid, but most of the time in the house, most of the time in the house. Yeah, Salat Sunnah, most of the time in the house, but he sometimes prayed in the masjid. And something else in this hadith, Hafsa said, this 1 hour before Fajr, Rasulullah ﷺ did not allow anyone to come in and disturb him. This is what's called khalwa. In other ibadah, when Rasulullah ﷺ in the ibadah, so people can go and disturb. But this 1 hour before Fajr, Hafsa said, Rasulullah said, no one allowed to come in. So Rasulullah really alone in that one, khalwa with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why the ulama said that from the sunnah, we should allocate a time every day to be alone with Allah. You sit in your place when you pray in your house, and allocate a time just to be with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't allow anyone to come or disturb or what you call khalwa. So this is the meaning of the hadith. Ah, yeah. But see, this Qiyamul Layl, the wife of Rasulullah can come and join, pray with him, or sometimes, for example, if they need something, can ask. But this 1 hour before Fajr, this one, no one allowed to touch. For any reason, no one allowed to come in. So let us say, for Rasulullah pray 3 hours, Qiyamul Layl. So the first hour, he prayed, so people can join, can disturb, can come and pray with him. But this 1 hour before Fajr, no one allowed. He's alone with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even to pray with him, not allowed.
Is it always muakkadah?
Sorry?
Is it muakkadah?
Yeah. Hafsa said this the hour, Rasulullah always not allowed to...
Not Fajr.
Okay, hadith number 62, which is Aisha, the same for Fajr. Rasul Aisha said that Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم لم يكن على شيء من النوافل أشد تعاهدا منه على ركعتي الفجر. وفي لفظ مسلم ركعتا الفجر خير من الدنيا وما فيها. Aisha said Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم never insist or do something of the nawafil more than the two rak'ah before Fajr. This is what Aisha said. This is the most two rak'ah Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم always do. And in the other hadith, same hadith Aisha relates, Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم said, this two rak'ah before Fajr, khayrun min ad-dunya wa ma fiha, is better than the whole world. See, how important it is, this two rak'ah before Fajr. See, but even it is very light, right? But this is the idea. The idea here doesn't matter if it's long or short. See, this two rak'at, it is very light, but the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says this two rak'at is better than the whole world. So what is good, what is bad, what Allah decides it is good, what Allah decides it is bad. Some people say, no, because, you know, I make my salah very long. No, just follow the sunnah. This is the best. It's not by doing something long or hard, no. The right or the best when you follow the sunnah. Follow as the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam do. He prays these two rak'at light, and the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, this two light rak'ah is better than the whole world. This is the importance of following the sunnah. So any
we still don't know what theory, no?
Sorry?
We still don't know what theory.
What?
Theory, sir.
No. Because what the Sahaba said, he prayed in very light way. So because when Rasulullah did not read less than 10 ayah in the after Fatiha. So when the Sahaba said he prayed this surah like he did not recite anything. It is really fast. It is really fast. Yeah, there's some hadith for Fadl, this one, but later inshallah we'll discuss. Because how you explain the hadith? It is one time or always? Because the Rasulullah said, Masallah Arba'an. So later inshallah, because we have one chapter only for Nawafil. So we'll talk about all this Nawafil and the important. But it is one time or always? Yeah. It's before Fajr, yes. Before a Fajr prayer. Yeah. Actually, the Salat should be after the second Adhan. Even in Selangor, there is some mosque in Selangor, some of them still practice to Adhan. After second Adhan. Yeah, after the second Adhan.
After the second.
Because in Ramadan, Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam practiced two adhan.
Okay. But normal days is the
yeah, because in the normal day, even sometimes the Rasulullah practice two adhan.
No, I mean during for the Nawafil, normal day is just the first adhan, yeah, after that.
No, second adhan. First adhan, not Fajr yet.
No, here I know that they do that. But in my hometown, no, they don't do that. So,
because if they have one adhan, it means they pray, they make adhan in the second one.
Before Iqamah.
Yeah, because you don't see the last time you did not attain. Because the Fajr have two times.
Okay.
Fajr have two times. Isha also have two times. So the Fajr have two times. The first one, when the Fajr starts, which is the night did not end, the Fajr did not start, in the middle here. And the other one, which is after it, around 1 hour, less than 1 hour, around 45 minutes, the second one, which is with the real Fajr. They call it Fajr al-Sadiq, in Arabic they mean the real Fajr. So Rasulullah make adhan here. This one is just to, what call, to make people wake up if they sleep, to prepare for the Fajr. But the real adhan for the Salat is the second one, which is the real Fajr. So those masjid who have one adhan, they make it in the real Fajr. Okay? Which is we pray after that immediately.
Which is the Nawafil is after that, right?
After that.
Okay.
Yeah, same. Yeah, exactly the same. Okay, then we have Bab al-Adhan, the last hadith, because we have 5 minutes. So Bab al-Adhan, hadith number 63, and Anas bin Malik radiallahu anhu qal, Amara umira Bilal an yashfa' al-Adhan wa yutur al-Iqama. Bilal giving an order. Who gives the order? Of course, we know Bilal are taking order only from Rasulullah. But here he did not say Rasulullah. He said Bilal giving an order. And we understand from this statement the order comes from Rasulullah. What is the order? When he make adhan, so it should be shafa. Shafa means twice. So it means Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. So it should be two times. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. So it should be twice. It means shafa. And the iqama, this is for the adhan. For the iqama, one. What else? So, okay. But here we have a huge argument between the ulama. طيب So now, for the Iqama, should be one, right? Because the Rasulullah says should be one. So for the Ahnaf, this hadith, they did not consider Al-Ahnaf. So that's why for the Ahnaf, Al-Adhan and Al-Iqama, say. this one before the Salat, and this one with the Salat. Because Iqama with the Salat, right? So, first one is the Adhan, second one with the Salat, which is iqama, but with iqama we have to add qad qamat as-salatu, qad qamat as-salatu. This one will be added. So for the Ahnaf, because they did not consider this hadith, so that's why for them al-iqama also same with adhan. So that's why when you go to Pakistan, for example, you go to Bangladesh, this all Hanafi area, you'll find this one. The iqama is like that. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. So they cut it like that. Till this, qad qamat as-salat, qad qamat as-salat, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, la ilaha illallah. So they do it like that. So, but the other madhab, which is al-Hanafiyya, al-Malikiyya, al-Shafi'iyya, al-Hanabila, they said no. They consider this hadith. So for them, al-Adhan twice, and al-Iqama, one. But here we have problem. When we say قد قامت الصلاة, so should we say قد قامت الصلاة, قد قامت الصلاة twice, or قد قامت الصلاة one? الأذان خلاص الأذان all of them agree all the madhab same, there is no disagreement in الأذان. The argument only in إقامة. Why? Because this hadith differentiates between أذان and إقامة. الأحناف, because they did not consider this hadith, for them الإقامة same with the أذان. So the other three madhab consider this hadith, so for them الإقامة different from الأذان. So what they should al-iqama? Only one. So we have, for example, this one. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. You make it half. So what becomes? Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Only. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. One. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Hayya ala salah. Hayya ala al-falah. Then here we have to add qad qamat al-salat, right? So here qad qamat al-salat, we have to say it two times or one time. For Hanabila and Shafi'iyya, they say two times. For Malikiyya, they say one time. Why one time? Because there is a hadith, Al-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he ordered Bilal for Iqama to make it only one time except Al-Iqama. Except Qad Qamat al-Salah. Means Qad Qamat al-Salah should be twice. That hadith considered by Shafi'iyya and Hanabila. Al-Malikiyya, they say, no, this hadith we did not consider. Why? Because Imam Malik have one of his principles, they call Amal Ahl al-Madina. Amal Ahl al-Madina, because Imam Malik from al-Tabi'een, right? And he saw al-Sahaba and the children of the Sahaba following a style. And in Medina, during his time, the masjid, all the masjid in Medina, they say قَدْ قَامَتُ الصَّلَاةُ one time. And for Imam Malik, this one considered as a hadith. Why? Because it's those people, because they are near to Rasulullah, they are following the same style for Imam Malik. Following the same style of Rasulullah. He said, since the Ahl al-Madina in my time saying Qamat al-Salah one time, this means they got it from Rasul. So that's why when they narrated this hadith to Imam Malik, he said, I will not consider. Why? Because this hadith against Amalu Ahl al-Madina. What Ahl al-Madina do, it is against, I will not consider the hadith. So now we have al-Iqama, three opinions. Al-Ahnaf, same like Adhan. Double. For Shafi'iyya and Hanabila, it is one time. Only Qad Qamat al-Salah, two times. Al-Malikiyya, all one. Even قد قامت الصلاة one time. So this is the opinion of the. Now they are Hanabila. Because now Saudi Arabia following al-Mazhab al-Hanbali, not Maliki anymore. Now Saudi Arabia dominant by al-Mazhab al-Hanbali. Most of the Gulf area. Kuwait, Emirat, most of this area now dominant by Hanbali. They're using Mazhab al-Hanbali. So this is what we have today. If you have any question or any comment or any.
Yeah. the hikmah, why is it made twice or single? Is there any hikmah behind why is it made twice?
No.
Later, because even is al adhan wal iqama wajib or sunnah? Jumhur ulama, they say it's a sunnah. Means if we pray without adhan and iqama, it's still okay. Al shafi'iyya, they say fardu kifaya. Fardu kifaya mean enough, some masjid do it. No, not necessarily all the masjid or all surah do it. Yes, still, because if you say it is the sunnah, if you do it, you will get ajr. If you did not do it, no harm.